third year postgraduate students of railway dnb and other faculty members who have joined us today for this academic session RACE dnb academic online activities to discuss theory questions. Today we have three theory questions. One is anesthesia for liver transplantation, and second is low flow anesthesia, and third one is point of care coagulation testing. I invite Dr. Pratik Shukla to present the topic on anesthesia for liver transplantation for the first. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, sir. Good evening, ma'am. So my topic for today's is liver anesthesia for liver transplant. So to begin with, I'll be dividing my topics into various subheads. First subhead is introduction. Liver transplant is the sole definitive treatment of the end stage liver disease, where medical management is of little significance when life-threatening complication of liver failure such as encephalopathy, GI bleedings or uremia like hepatorenal syndrome seeps in. That is, broadly we can say, when decompensated liver disease seeps in, we have to go for surgical intervention only. The team for liver transplant anesthesia includes a hepatologist, a surgeon, a nephrologist, a critical care physician, anesthesiologist, radiologist, pathologist, infectious disease physician, and a pediatrician, along with a well-trained nurse and a OT attendant staffs. So successful liver transplant requires not only the surgeon's skills, but also the experienced anesthesiologist who knows these steps of surgeries grossly and anticipates the complication beforehand and thus treat accordingly, not only in the OR, but also perioperatively. So now moving on, indications of the liver transplant. Mainly it can be divided as non-cholestatic, which comprises of the major part of the liver transplant, when 61% of the patients are cholestatic.
Can you speak a little louder, please, Pratik?
Yes, ma'am.
Speak a little louder.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Indications for liver transplant is mainly divided as non-cholestatic, which comprises of 61% cholestatic diseases. Second one is cholestatic disease. Third one is acute hepatic necrosis. Fourth one is biliary atresia. Fifth are metabolic disorders, and sixth is malignant diseases. So for under pediatric and adults, non-cholestatic diseases can be further subdivided as, for adults, primary biliary cirrhosis, primary sclerosing cholangitis, autoimmune hepatitis, cryptogenic cirrhosis, viral hepatitis with cirrhosis, alcoholic cirrhosis, primary hepatocellular malignancy, and fulminant hepatitis. For pediatric population, liver transplant is done for cases of congenital hepatic fibrosis, biliary atresia, alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, Wilson's disease, metabolic diseases, glucagon storage disorder, Kligler-Nasar syndrome, familial hypercholesterolemia. Contraindications of liver transplant should also be known, which can be subdivided into absolute and relative. Absolute contraindications for liver transplants are active sepsis, active substance abuse or alcohol abuse, advanced cardiac diseases, extrahepatic malignancy, metastatic malignancy, and cholangiocarcinoma. While relative contraindications to liver transplant are severe obesity, severe pulmonary hypertension, severe cardiomyopathy, high viral load of HIV. The patient for liver transplant is almost always associated with several comorbidities. Thus, it is important to know the pathophysiology of liver disease affecting the multiple systems of our body. So going with the central nervous system, nearly 80% of acute liver failure patients develop cerebral edema and increased intracranial pressure. In case of chronic liver failure also, cerebral edema might not be present, but increased ICP is present, and in these both cases, it can be attributed to the development of hepatic encephalopathy, which can be of multiple stages. And hepatic encephalopathy mainly develops due to the failure of hepatic clearance, therefore accumulation of toxins such as ammonia and manganese is there, leading to alteration in the endogenous neurotransmitters like GABA, glutamine, and nitrous oxide. And since urea cycle is absent in brain, therefore accumulation of glutamine in the glial cells astrocyte causes cerebral edema also. Now going on to second system, that is cardiovascular system. End stage liver diseases develop hyperdynamic circulation, which is characterized by increased cardiac output and alveolar vasodilation. And this may be attributed due to the bypass of the vasoactive substance, which normally hepatic metabolism, which undergoes normal hepatic metabolism. Cardiomyopathy has also been associated with cirrhosis and hematochromatosis, and most of the patients are alcoholic. So alcoholic cardiomyopathy, which is dilated cardiomyopathy, is also seen. Arrhythmia is also seen due to acid-base abnormality and electrolyte imbalance. And most of the adults or elderly are atherosclerotic. So coronary artery disease, CAD, is also predominant in the patient of hepatic, means patient undergoing liver transplant. So so to predict this means, okay, we can discuss that in testing. Under respiratory system, pulmonary complications associated with liver diseases can be included under restrictive lung diseases due to development of ascites and pleural effusion. Also, side by side, VQ abnormality, pulmonary hypertension is also seen. And there is a specific symptoms of pulmonary system, like hepatopulmonary symptom, which occur in 20% patient who present for liver transplant, for which diagnostic criteria includes portal hypertension, PaO2 less than 70 mm of Hg on room air, and evidence of intrapulmonary vasodilation dilatation. Our third or fourth criteria can be AA gradient more than 15 mm of Hg. And second major portopulmonary hypertension is also seen in the patients presenting with decompensated liver diseases, which is defined as pulmonary hypertension in presence of portal hypertension in patient without other predisposing factor. Now moving on to renal system, it is important to identify the patient with advanced renal diseases who need liver or kidney, means they might need both liver and kidney transplant simultaneously to treat the thus kidney disorders like hepatorenal syndrome is one of the major thing we should diagnose pre-op. So hepatorenal syndrome is a functional cause of renal failure, and to diagnose this, clinical features like proteinuria, hypovolemia in absence of any primary renal disease, evidence of renal hypoperfusion, urinary sodium level less than 10 milliequivalents per liter is the diagnostic criteria. In MAM, HRS means that hepatorenal syndrome, the RAS system is stimulated. Therefore, as the liver diseases progress, there is an increase in the ADH, therefore decreased water excretion, and thus leading to dilutional hyponatremia. In advanced cirrhosis, there is intense renal vasoconstriction, therefore decreased GFR, thus this contributes to the vicious cycle of hepatorenal syndrome. It can be treated by terlipressin. In the GI system, mainly patient develops esophageal varices, portal hypertension, and ascites. Portal hypertension is diagnosed by measuring the wedged hepatic venous pressure. The normal pressure is around 3 to 5 mm of Hg. More than 8 mm of Hg is classified as portal hypertension. Gold standard to diagnose esophageal varices. The gold standard to diagnose esophageal varices is esophagogastroduodenoscopy, and the risk for the variceal bleeding correlates with the size of varices, presence of red valve marks, and the variceal pressure. Ma'am, ascites. Ascites is one of the very common thing which we see during a patient in a liver cirrhosis. It should be treated preoperatively with diuretics and paracentesis, and moreover, the SAG means serum albumin gradient, serum ascitic albumin gradient, gives an idea about portal hypertension. Hematological and coagulation system disorders. Anemia is very common in liver cirrhotic patient due to malnutrition and due to the bleeding via the varices, or means hemorrhoids, ma'am, due to hemorrhoids also. Portal means because portocoel anastomosis is there also, ma'am, around the anus. So coagulation defect is second thing under second subtopic under hematological and coagulation disorder. Is coagulation defect is due to the decreased synthesis of clotting factor, vitamin K is, and synthesis of abnormal clotting factor, or decreased clearance of activated factors, thus leading to hyperfibrinolysis, and patient lands up into DIC. Thrombocytopenia is also seen in the patients of liver cirrhosis due to decreased level of thrombopoietin or active sepsis or DIC. Clotting factors, which are means which are made in means liver, are 2, 7, 9, and 10. We have also have to keep an eye about the drug metabolism. End stage liver disease patients are sensitive to many drugs. Therefore, action of many drugs are prolonged, including opioids, NDM, non-depolarizing muscle relaxant, etc. Thus, dose reduction may be required. Special attention about the decreased plasma cholinesterase level should be also kept in mind, which is decreased due to since it is produced in liver. Therefore, prolonged duration of action of drugs like succinylcholine, mebacurium, esmolol, and remifentanil should be kept in the mind. Liver transplant surgeries can be broadly divided under two heads: organ retrieval surgeries and liver transplant surgeries, organ transplant surgeries. So mainly I'll be dealing, means discussing about the later one, but to suffice about the organ retrieval surgeries, it can be studied under three heads: organ retrieval from the cadaver, which is always an emergency case, organ retrieval from a brain dead patient, or live donor organ retrieval. Now, so now moving on to liver transplant surgeries. So pre-op consideration for transplant patient selection. Earlier, Child-Pugh Turret classification was used to assess the disease severity, and thus it governed the organ transplant wait list in the US. It consisted of serum bilirubin, serum albumin, PTINR, ascitic grading, and hepatic encephalopathy. As it is a very subjective type of grading, because someone can grade hepatic encephalopathy as grade 2, grade 3. So it is now outdated, and nowadays we use MELD, that is model for end stage liver diseases grade scoring, to prioritize the patient for liver transplant wait list. And for the pediatric population, it is PELD. MELD score is based on three lab results, which are bilirubin, creatinine, and INR. MELD score is given by the formula, which it's a complicated formula. It goes like 0.597 into log E serum creatinine plus 0.378 log E total serum bilirubin plus 1.120 log E into INR. In this, we have to multiply the resulting value by 10 and round up to nearest whole number. The minimum value for all the these parameters of bilirubin, creatinine, and INR is 1.0, while maximum value of serum creatinine we used to take 4.0, being patient on dialysis for twice or thrice a week. Prior to the surgery, which are required are hemoglobin, total leukocyte count, differential leukocyte count, liver function test, renal function test, coagulation profile including PTINR, baseline ECG, chest X-ray, USG abdomen, echo in patient of suspicion of cardiomyopathy, arterial blood gas analysis, RBS, blood sugar level monitoring, urine RM. Stress test is required if patient is suspected of coronary artery disease, or else it is not as such required. As far as possible, patient should be optimized according to the deficits in the suggested investigations, and then we should proceed to the surgery. So now moving on to OR room preparation and patient monitoring. As significant blood loss is anticipated, thus wide bore cannulas of 14 to 16 gauze with or without central line with rapid infusion pump, if available, should be used. Routine hemodynamic monitoring like pulse rate, saturation, ECG, along with special monitoring like intra-arterial pressure monitoring, transesophageal echo, central venous catheterization, pulmonary artery catheterization in patient with portopulmonary hypertension or cirrhotic cardiomyopathy is advocated. Special attention should be kept that whenever we are using pulmonary artery catheter, then transesophageal echo is not used, and vice versa is also true. Other routine ASA monitoring includes temperature, capnograph, and urine output. Preoperatively, administration of oral immunosuppressant and bowel decontamination with antibiotics is to be done. Position during surgery, mostly semi-upright position up to 20 degree tilt during induction will prevent the rapid oxygen desaturation. We have to keep in mind, means if intra-op venovenous hemodialysis is available, then it will be a very useful tool for fluid volume monitoring and electrolyte management with marginal or decreased renal function patient. And we have to be sure, we have to be sure that three working suction machines are present in the operating room. Now moving on to induction. Induction is to be done via rapid sequence induction since most of the patients have
fasciitis. Can you go louder, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Again, you've gone back to your...
Sorry, ma'am. Induction. Induction is to be done via rapid sequence induction. Since most of the patient have ascites, therefore it can be classified as full stomach patient with decreased function FRC. So induction agent of choice is propofol. Muscle relaxant which should be used is selected by keeping in the mind about the patient profile like CKD and CLD. In majority of the cases, sesatracurium would be the choice to go with due to its organ independent elimination and low histamine production. And as such, no dose alteration would be required for sesatracurium. Opioids like fentanyl is selected to blunt the sympathetic response to the stimulation to provide smooth transition from operative to post-op period also. Volatile anesthetic is to be given in low to moderate concentration since low to moderate concentration of 0.5 to 1 mAq. In recipient of fulminant hepatic failure or cerebral edema, the volatile agent is avoided or used in very low concentration with intracranial monitoring, intracranial pressure monitoring. In case of period of hypotension or in case of raised ICP, discontinue the volatile anesthetic and at that time, midazolam can be used for its amnestic effects. Nitrous oxide is generally avoided now. Volatile agent of choice is isoflurane since it preserves the splanchnic blood flow and is better than any volatile drug, and it has vasodilator effect on the hepatic circulation on contrary with the effect of halothane which causes vasoconstrictive effect on the liver. Therefore, it is beneficial on hepatic oxygen supply and gives added advantage of the newly perfused graft. Hyperventilation should be avoided in cases of increased ICP pressure, ma'am. In patient of increased ICP. Fluid management, goal-directed hemodynamic and fluid management is advocated using transesophageal probe or esophageal Doppler or arterial pulse wave analyzer. And now going on to grossly on the surgery. Liver transplant surgery is divided into three phases. First phase is pre and hepatic phase of surgery, also known as dissection plane. It begins with the surgical incision and ends with the cross clamping of the portal vein, suprahepatic IVC and infrahepatic IVC and the hepatic artery. Due to abdominal incision and drainage of the ascites or surgical entry directly into the large varices, patient may land up into hypotension. Therefore, hypotension which can be due to blood loss or which can be due to fluid loss of ascites. Therefore, if hypovolemia is due to fluid loss of ascites, it should be treated with crystalloids or colloids depending upon the renal function of the patient prior to the surgery. And if blood loss is there, then it should be replaced with blood. If patient lands up into coagulopathy during this phase, then we should treat it with fresh frozen plasma. So to diagnose coagulopathy, point of care viscoelastic coagulation assay like TEG and ROTEM should be done routinely in these cases. To diagnose decreased hemoglobin, intraoperative serial hematocrit to guide RBC replacement is very good. Serial blood gas analysis, serum electrolyte and serum ionized calcium and serum glucose monitoring should also be routinely done in these cases. During surgery, if blood transfusion is carried out, then always we have to keep in mind about the citrate levels, because there is no liver to metabolize it. Therefore, ionized calcium monitoring becomes important. If needed, calcium salts can be given prophylactic also, like calcium chloride. Hyponatremia should not be corrected rapidly to avoid osmotic demyelination of the brain, like central pontine myelolysis, because most of the patients are generally hyponatremic in these cases. While in cases of hyperkalemia, it should be corrected promptly with diuresis, and if required, hemodialysis can also be done if it is available in the OR. For hypokalemia, it should not be treated vigorously, because during reperfusion, potassium level will rise again. Second phase of the surgery is an hepatic phase of the surgery, which begins with the occlusion of vascular inflow to the liver and ends with the graft reperfusion. In this phase, due to cross clamping of the suprahepatic and infrahepatic IVC, there is decrease of the venous return by 50%. Therefore, veno-venous bypass, when used, diverts the IVC and portal vein flow to the axillary artery. Therefore, it attenuates the decreased preload and improves the renal perfusion pressure. And also, it lessens the splanchnic congestion, therefore delaying the development of metabolic acidosis. The complication of veno-venous bypass include air embolism, accidental decannulation. Therefore, to avoid this, sometimes surgeons use a technique called as piggyback technique, which is used to, in this technique, they used to preserve the IVC. Therefore, there is no use of, thus they don't use the veno-venous bypass, thus avoiding the side effects like complications like air embolism and accidental decannulation. Third phase of the surgery is neohepatic phase. Neohepatic phase means reperfusion of the new liver through the portal vein marks the beginning of neohepatic phase, and mainly it has two pathophysiological events associated with this phase. First one is reperfusion syndrome. That is due to cold and acidotic hyperkalemic solution that is present inside the grafted organ, which may also contain emboli and vasoactive substance when flushed from the graft directly into IVC, it may lead to hypotension, right heart syndrome, arrhythmia, and even cardiac arrest. Hallmark feature of post-perfusion syndrome, systemic hypotension, post-perfusion syndrome are systemic hypotension with pulmonary hypertension occurring within 5 minutes after reperfusion. And this can be prevented by prophylactic administration of calcium chloride and soda bicarb administration. If required, salbutamol, albuterol with insulin can be given if hyperkalemia or arrhythmia, hyperkalemia is suspected if arrhythmia seeps in. Second pathophysiological event associated with neohepatic phase is ischemia or reperfusion injury, which results from impaired reperfusion due to severe endothelial dysfunction, and it may lead to the non-function of the graft or graft rejection at all. Hepatic artery anastomosis and biliary reconstruction are performed after venous reperfusion, although in pediatric patient, the arterial anastomosis is completed before reperfusion. So now we have to see that a patient has taken up the graft, means signs of graft function inside the OR. It can be assessed by production of the bile, decreased calcium requirement, improvement in the acidosis of the patient, acidotic phase of the patient, increased urine output, increase in the core temperature of the patient. Fibrinolysis is also one of the most most severe after reperfusion. And it is caused due to means abrupt rise in the tissue plasminogen activator from the graft endothelial cell, and therefore antifibrinolytic drugs like tranexamic acid and epsilon aminocaproinoic acid can be used, but it is not advocated to be used as prophylactically. If required, then only we should use this. Post-op management, most of the transplant patients are transferred to the ICU intubated and mechanically ventilated. In some patient, immediate post-op extubation may be considered if patient is comfortable, cooperative, physiologically stable, and not hemorrhaging significantly. Post-op analgesia, we can give it via epidural catheter if normal coagulation profile patient is there. Via patient-controlled analgesia with opioids like fentanyl can be given. Prior to surgeries, we can put up a patch. Opioid patch to the patient 24 hours prior to the surgery. Local infiltration of the local anesthetic drug at the incisional site can be done. NSAIDs, if renal means non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, can be given if renal function is within if it allows. Post-op complication which can be anticipated in these cases are surgical complications like post-op bleeding, biliary drainage leak, vascular thrombosis, fluid overload, metabolic abnormality, particularly metabolic alkalosis is anticipated in these patients, respiratory failure, pleural effusion, acute kidney injury, acute tubular necrosis of the kidney, systemic infection. Post of graft function is monitored by investigations like PT, prothrombin time, serum bilirubin, AST and LTS. This is, ma'am, I conclude, ma'am. This is how I conclude.
Okay, all right. Okay, Pratik, so far you've done really well as far as anesthesia for liver transplant is concerned. So what you started off is the types of non-cholestatic, cholestatic, and then pediatric and the adult and all that. So I don't think you have to waste time on those things. Okay, yes, on the types and what are we taking up. So what you can say is the prognosis of a patient coming up for a liver transplant depends upon the indication that the patient is coming for. If it is a patient with alcoholic liver failure, then the prognosis is poor. That is what we are concerned, isn't it? Like on the table, they can have problems. Post-operatively, they can have problems. That's why. Otherwise, if they have a primary liver disease, a small thing, like in children, like you have small malignancy, things like that, then the prognosis is very good. So that aspect alone, if you mention it, is enough. You don't have to waste so much time on saying cholestatic, non-cholestatic, and all. You can just cut that out completely. Okay.
Yes,
and then next you said was about the contraindication and relative contraindication. Of course, you need, but like for us, it is not absolutely necessary to know completely about the nothing, but we definitely need to know contraindications for anything. In fact, any procedure that you come, if the patient is coming up for that, it is okay to mention it, but don't elaborate on that. Okay, that's one thing. And then encephalopathy also, we went on to say several things which were not required. What you can just say is, what is hepatic encephalopathy? Why does it come? How do you prevent it? And what the patient is on, that you didn't mention at all. You didn't mention about oral antibiotics, neomycin, and how to give less protein. Those things are what makes a difference to the anesthesia.
Yes,
we don't have to say about anything else because you wasted a lot of time on those things. How long did you take to write the whole question, whole answer?
Ma'am, I took around 45-50 minutes, ma'am. It took.
Yeah, so you don't have that much time, is it? When you go for the exam, you don't have that much time. So you maybe keep it at half an hour. If you keep the whole thing at half an hour, then you will avoid all this. So just say points. And encephalopathy, you just say, what is encephalopathy? What is the cause? How do you prevent? What is the treatment? That's all. And cardiovascular, you did well. You did about the hyperdynamic circulation. You did systemic vascular resistance. You said arrhythmia. You said cardiomyopathy. You said effusion. All that is fine. But in the respiratory system, you were not very clear about the portopulmonary hypertension and the hepatopulmonary hypertension. There, you have to mention the differences between the portopulmonary hepatopulmonary. It's enough if you say that. And that word about orthodeoxia has to be there. Though we don't talk about it we don't know, but if it is there, then we know that you know about the liver failure, okay, orthodeoxia. Then, of course, the renal was good. You said hepatic hepatorenal syndrome, and you basically said it's functional, which is good. And again, you don't have to elaborate on that. And on the GI also, you just need to mention portal hypertension, ascites, and did not mention about the diagnosis. There you came and mentioned about how to diagnose, what is that type of thing. Those things can be completely avoided. Okay, it's not necessary at all. Those lines can be completely taken off. And then you went on to hematological, which is good, the coagulation factors. But here, very specifically, you write what are the coagulation factors secreted by the liver, why these are absent, and in the stages, what is, and the investigations. When you talk about this, when you go to the investigations, then you mention about the prothrombin time and APTT and prolongation and all that. So then it makes more sense. Okay.
Yes.
So then you didn't mention it. You did not even mention what are the coagulation factors which are actually secreted by the liver. You know, so that most of them are secreted by the liver, but vitamin K dependent factors, because again, absorption is not there. All those things you have to mention there. All that is fine. And then a very important thing which you really didn't mention before the thing was the action of the anesthetic agents. You must write about intravenous agents, inhalation agents, muscle relaxants. You did mention it, but you are not at all very clear about it. What you can say is how the MAC value changes. And because you can say the liver disease producing changes in the MAC value of inhalation agent. Of course, you said about isoflurane, but another important thing which you need to mention is about the fast tracking. Nowadays, what they do is, even in liver transplant patients, they do fast tracking. So there they mention desflurane and they don't mention isoflurane. Okay, so you could probably make a note there, then it'll become like a very authentic thing to say. You know, at the end of the session, you can probably say about fast tracking post liver transplant, you know, get the patient out fast. Okay, so there they do not say about isoflurane, they always talk about desflurane. That's something you need to say. And again, you did mention about succinylcholine, remifentanil, all those things which will increase because of the pseudocholinesterase not being there. But in spite of it, we do use succinylcholine for RSI. For rapid sequence intubation, we will still use it. So that's what you said. That was okay. Then when you came to the liver transplant itself, now only we are coming to the actual thing about liver transplant. Okay, so this was okay. So you cut off in the beginning, you cut off all that non-cholestatic and things like that. And in encephalopathy, again, you make it very clear. And again, you don't talk about the investigations when you come to the GI. And you did not mention about preparation of the patient. You spoke about pre-op evaluation. You spoke about the CTP score and the MELT score. But you have to mention that. Without the CTP score, you have to mention all the parameters, the number. We have to mention the number. And the MELT score, though, of course, you said all this complicated formula. I don't think we'll remember that even if we look at it. In fact, we'll have to refer the book to make a correction there. So anyway, so that needs to be mentioned. That is good. Anyway, you thought about that. And and suppose it's an emergency, and I said you have to talk whether it's an elective or an emergency. So sometimes what happens is, you also said in the liver, in the investigation, when you initial itself, when you said, you spoke about whether it is a donor or the recipient. You're talking only about the recipient, not talking about the donor. So if we are getting a cadaveric liver transplant, orthotic, we're getting a full liver transplant, then only it becomes an emergency. So the patient will be called in. So, and a lot of factors which determine how the post-operative care of this patient is going to be, especially if the patient has been in the hospital for very long, the patient has had a dialysis, the patient had a low hemoglobin, things like that. So those will make more sense if you mention it in the pre-op. You spoke about evaluation quite well, and you said about the investigations, but you did not say anything about the preparation of the patient. So, yeah, so we need to say preparation of the patient. And then, of course, RSI, you said. You never mentioned about the tips. What is tips?
Yes.
What is tips? You never mentioned tips.
Transjugular
interval. Yeah, so sometimes these patients will have a portosystemic anastomosis, isn't it? So when they have that, these patients with the tips, when they come and you induce anesthesia, sometimes they go for encephalopathy. So you need to mention that word. You need to mention that word tips there. Okay. And then you spoke about fluids. Fluids, you said. But you're not saying, you said glucose-containing fluid, all that you said. You didn't say, actually. You said you only during investigations, you were saying intraoperatively, you will check the electrolytes, glucose, all that you were saying. But you did not mention what fluid you will use. You were talking about sometimes dysloid, sometimes colloid. Things like that is very vague. You can't just say that. What do you normally use? What is it for a fluid that can be used? Plasmalite A is the solution which is used nowadays because for the what is the difference between ringer lactate and plasmalite?
Difference, ma'am.
This is lactate. Okay, I'll tell you.
Yes.
Ringer is the lactate, and we don't want lactate because lactate cannot be metabolized, things like that. And this plasmalite, the potassium content of plasmalite is lower than that of the ringer lactate. Okay, so and when you use plasmalite A, it is acetated plasmalite, right? So if you use that, it is a much better solution to use than using anything else. If you use just normal saline, again, you're going to have hyperchloremic acidosis. So don't use that also. So we use a lot of plasmalite and blood transfusion. So you mentioned it only during the procedure, but it is good to know about how much of blood you will reserve. When you spoke about the investigations, you did not mention blood grouping. So in a big way, you must mention that. And did you mention or did I miss it?
Ma'am, I missed it.
You mentioned?
I missed it, ma'am.
Oh, you missed it. Okay, then I was right. All right. Okay, so you must write in a big way. You must about the grouping. And you must say that so much of blood and blood products you will keep ready on hand. It's not enough that you say only during the intraoperative period. You must say in the preoperative period itself how much you will keep. So many units you have to keep. How many units will normally be required? It's massive blood transfusion, is it?
Yes,
nearly
yes,
10 or 10
yes,
of packed cells, FFP, platelets, everything. In fact, sometimes you might even have to use cryoprecipitate and all that because of the massive hemorrhage that can happen. Okay, yes, so that's one. When you came on to the actual thing of three phases and all that, that's very good. So there you can make a tabular column. Have you made a tabular column there?
No, ma'am, not tabulated.
Okay, that see, is there is a, in, if you go to BJ, British Journal of Anesthesia Educational thing, it is for students, I think it is free. You can just go there and register. BJ is one of the best sites you can have to get most of the thing, Medscape and BJ. Okay, you'll get, and it has special edition for postgraduates. So if you can get that, there they will have a big tabular column. It'll say about the three phases, the pre-anhepatic, the anhepatic, and the post-perfusion after the anastomosis. So there they will put a tabular column and they will tell you about what happens in each phase. So what is common in all the phases is the hypotension and hemorrhage. Okay, it can happen any phase. So you need to be prepared. So you must say what you anticipate, what are the problems you're anticipating in every phase and how you will tackle that problem. So if you mention it that way, it makes a lot more sense than keeping on writing sentence after sentence. So you put a tabular column, you say the three phases, you say the problems that can come. On the side, you say what does the anesthetist do to prevent this complication? To prevent this complication and to treat the complication if it occurs. So if you write it that way, the whole thing will be complete. It'll be just excellent. Okay. So far it was very good. All that was very good. And you said about the post-op pain management, you said about epidural. So that is a very controversial thing because we do use epidural when they have no coagulation factors and all that, no coagulation problems. We do use epidural, but this in patient with for liver transplant, we need to be careful about using the epidural. So you have to mention there very specifically. You did mention, but you have to mention it. You must highlight it. And what about paracetamol? Can we use? We cannot use.
We should not use, ma'am. Acetaminophen should not be used in these cases.
Yeah, paracetamol is coin. So you must mention that, doesn't it? Okay. When we talk about analgesia, we always talk about multimodal analgesia, right?
Yes,
so
yes,
again, so you are talking about contraindication and relative contraindication for liver transplant, but you did not talk about contraindication of the drugs that they're going to use. Yeah, you did not mention about paracetamol. You did not mention about morphine. These are contraindicated, right? Yes, morphine is contraindicated. Paracetamol is contraindicated. You must mention that.
Yes,
so that is something you have to mention. Of course, on the table, you said everything. You said RSI, all that you did very well, no problem at all. And post-op, this is what you need to mention that. And the anesthetic complications and surgical complications. You can't say it is only surgical complication and you can't be doing anything about it. Suppose the patient is bleeding. They'll be calling you only, to anesthetize the patient again. So you will have to be ready for that also. So again, you have to be ready with all the things that you need to do as a patient that will come for an actual liver transplant. Okay, only thing in here, it'll be a more of an emergency. It'll become more stressful for everybody. Okay,
yes,
so I think we did everything. I think you spoke about everything. Only the IV fluids, massive blood transfusion, and not to mention certain things so that you will have time
cut short.
To finish it
cut
within short. 30 minutes. Yes, you have to cut short and give more importance to our anesthetic technique and what you will do to prevent complications. And write it like that. Okay, write three tabular columns and write it like that. I think otherwise it's very good. Excellent. Well done.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
All right. Okay. We'll go on to the next one.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, Dr. Pratik Shukla. Next is low flow anesthesia by Dr. Arun from Maharashtra.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, good evening. Please go ahead.
I'm going to present about the point of care coagulation testing, madam.
Oh, coagulation, sorry, okay.
Point of care coagulation testing, madam. Definition, it is a rapid specific testing of body fluids at the bedside. Need for this study is to reduce the turnaround time of conventional laboratory test and the aim of reducing the inappropriate transfusion. Advantages of point of care coagulation testing is that it has a fast turnaround compared with the conventional laboratory based testing, madam. Whole blood often used, here whole blood is often used, which allows the interaction between the plasma, clotting factors, platelets and red blood cells. Real-time visual display of clot evaluation is seen, and there is a reduction of non-evidence-based transfusion. Disadvantages are, it measures coagulation in artificial condition rather than inside a blood vessel. Training and a competent staff required. Rigorous quality assurance standards are needed, and it's expensive. We'll see about the viscoelastic point of care devices. They provide the continuous measurement and display of viscoelastic properties of whole blood from initial phase of fibrin formation to clot retraction and ultimately fibrinolysis. Two types of tests are there, madam. Thromboelastography and rotational thromboelastography, sonoclot. First, we'll see about the thromboelastography. It's used to monitor coagulation in cardiac and liver surgeries patient. Now it is increasingly used in trauma and IC units. It was developed by Dr. Helmut Arpet. It monitors the thermodynamic properties of blood under a low shear environment. It determines the kinetic, growth, strength and stability of the formed clot. The procedure involves adding a 0.36 ml of whole blood placed in a rotating cup of 4 to 45 degree in a cycle of 6 cycles per minute. And a sensor shaft is attached to the tip of the needle, and a clot forms between the cup and the sensor is measured in a computer. Parameters interpreted are, shall I show the diagram, madam?
Yes, please.
Thanks. Diagram involves this, all these parameters are, it represents the, this is the wave in the normal graph, madam. Amplitude x axis is time on y axis. Hello?
Yeah, we can see it very well, but it's okay. I know what it is. That's okay. I have the diagram. Tell me.
Yes, that R represents the initial clot formation, and it represents the coagulation factor activity, and the K represents up to the rise in the initial amplitude up to the 20 mm amplitude of wave mm, and it is measured, it is a measurement of the clot kinetics, and the alpha angle represents the angle between the baseline time from the initial clot formation. It indicates the thrombin burst and the conversion of fibrinogen to fibrin, and the maximum amplitude, M is the maximum amplitude that is needed. And the maximum amplitude interpretation, 80% of which is from platelet and 20% from the fibrin. And A30 is the amplitude 30 minutes from the maximum amplitude, madam. It indicates the interprets fibrinolysis. Based on the results, we can interpret in clotting factor deficiency, there will be increased.
Your voice is breaking, Rajesh. Your voice is breaking.
Madam, and the treatment will be the administration of fresh frozen plasma because there is a just a minute. Hello,
we're not able to follow you, Rajesh. I'm not able to follow you. Oh. Your voice is breaking.
Just a minute.
Yeah, it's better now. Better now.
Okay, madam. Shall I continue the presentation, madam?
Yes.
Based on the interpretation, in clotting factor deficiency, there will be a prolongation of R time, madam. In the tech elastograph graph, there will be a prolongation of R time. And in fibrinogen deficiency, the alpha angle will be reduced, and the administration is, we have to administer cryoprecipitate. And in low platelet count, the amplitude, the maximum amplitude of the thromboelastogram is reduced. So administration of platelets is the treatment. And in thrombosis and hypercoagulable state, there will be increase in the maximum amplitude, and there is a need for administration of anticoagulants. And in primary fibrinolysis lytic state and secondary due to DAC, there will be a decrease in the amplitude at 30 minutes. So mainstay of treatment would be administration of antifibrinolytics. Next,
Very good.
We'll go to.
I think that is the most important aspect of the treatment itself. So we need to know what happens in every step so that you will know what exactly to give. Otherwise, what happens, we do not have this point of care testing, coagulation testing. We will just empirically keep giving, isn't it? We give antifibrinolytics, then we give platelets, then we give cryo, like that. So this makes it very specific. So that is what you need to understand. You must write that point, okay? What happens with R, what happens to the alpha angle, and what is the drug that you will give for that? If you write that down, itself is very good. All right, okay. Okay, thank you.
Next, we'll go to rotational thromboelastography. It is a modification of thromboelastogram. Here, the usually in take, the movement will be around the cup. In the procedure, the movement will be around the cup. But in a rotational thromboelastography,
can others hear him? I'm not able to hear him. Are others able to hear him?
No, ma'am, I'm also not able to hear him.
Okay, okay. Rajesh,
are you there? Madam, my voice audible, madam. Hello?
Yes, okay. Yeah, okay.
There is some problem with the network here, madam. Sorry, ma'am. Continuing my presentation, madam. Rotational thromboelastography is a modification of TEC. Here, usually the movement originates from the pin and not from the cup. And the signal of the pin is transmitted using an optical detector. It uses an electronic pipette, improving the reproducibility and performance of the test. Next is sonoclot. It incorporates a very sensitive viscoelastic detection system, and it is very sensitive to the changes in the developing clot. The principle of the test is, it measures the changing impedance to movement imposed by developing clot on a small probe vibrating at an ultrasonic frequency in a coagulating blood sample. Hello?
You continue. I muted my call because if I speak, there's an echo. So that's why I muted. You continue. You continue. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. The thromboelastogram and rotational thromboelastometry strengths. We'll first see about the strengths of this test. It provides the rapid assessment of overall coagulation status of patient and guide parameters for blood components administration. And it analyzes all three phases of coagulation, reflecting the interactions of cellular and plasma components of the coagulation. TEC and Rotem based transfusion algorithm show chances of reduced transformation and reduced surgical re-exploration. It usually detects hypercoagulable state in the post-op patients, and it is useful in detecting inadequate heparin or inadequate reversal in cardiac patients. Limitations of the tests are, it cannot reflect the contribution of the endothelium to coagulation. It will not reflect the effects of hypothermia and coagulation. The baseline preoperative values are usually the poor predictors of postoperative bleeding. And the tracings are insensitive to aspirin and coagulant, the clopidogrel. Next is platelet function testing devices. There is four tests, platelet function analyzer 100, TEC platelet mapping, verify now and multiplatelet. All these tests are used to detect the platelet functioning in patients having taking aspirin and P2Y12 antagonists like clopidogrel and tresigrogel, and then GP2B
and in patients with GP3A antagonist. First, we'll see about the platelet function analyzer 100. It measures the platelet adhesion and aggregation under high shear conditions. The procedure involves vacuum induced flow of citrated blood across a collagen coated membrane with the 150 micrometer aperture to which platelet activators like ephedrine or ADP bonded, resulting in platelet activation and aggregation. Interpretation is
epinephrine.
Interpretation is based in time for the platelet plug to occlude flow through aperture is the closure time. Usually it's a duration of 5 to 8 minutes. Both epinephrine and adenosine diphosphate closure time is prolonged in 1 millibrand disease, but only the epinephrine closure time is prolonged on patient taking aspirin, whereas the ADP closure time is usually normal. Other tests include the
So that is basically for epinephrine. It's basically for assessing aspirin sensitivity. So that is the idea of platelet function analyzer, to know whether it is because of the aspirin or not. Okay, that is the main thing. And okay, of course, the other drugs.
Yes.
Like not fully evaluated. Actually, they're not currently recommended for to monitor clopidogrel and all that. It's only for aspirin.
Yes, ma'am. Only for aspirin.
The platelet function analyzer. Yes. Okay.
Whereas the other tests is like tech platelet mapping, verify now and multiplatelet, they are all used to assess all the function platelet functioning in all three anticoagulants statement, like in aspirin and in clopidogrel and in GP2B and 3 antagonist state also we can find out what are all the platelet function deficiencies we can see.
Very good. Yeah. Yeah,
next
good.
Is.
So, we will go and do the other one rather than do the initial one just for the platelet function analyzer, isn't it? Because never the patient is on a single antiplatelet. They're always on multiple drugs. So, yes, we need to know about the GP2B, 3A, all that. All we need to know all that. Yes. So, it is better we go for a higher one and know about the platelet mapping assay or the multiplate device. Okay? Yes. All right. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Next is clotting factor test, madam. There is a new test called Coigo Check Pro DM. It uses the whole blood activated with soya bean and phospholipids to derive the PT, APTT and INR values. These values are mostly incomparable with the laboratory tests. Next is an heparin test. Test to monitor heparin efficiency is the activated coagulation.
Can you repeat? No. Can you repeat what you said about this clotting factor test?
Coago Check Pro DM.
Okay.
It uses the whole blood activated with soya bean and phospholipids to derive the PT, APTT and INR values.
Okay.
Next test for heparin, madam. ACT.
Okay.
Activated clotting time is a test of coagulation. It is mainly used in cardiac bypass surgeries, interventional cardiology, thrombolysis, and in ECMO. It is usually measured in seconds. It is measured as seconds needed for whole blood to clot upon activation of intrinsic pathway by adding factor 12 activators. The endpoint of coagulation is usually determined by two methods, optical and mechanical. In optical, increasing the opacity of blood by optical sensors. In mechanical, increase the rigidity detected by the displacement of the material in the vial. Usually, the reference range is between 70 to 120 seconds.
What's the normal range? 70. Normal range is?
70 to 120 seconds, madam.
70 to 120, 90 to 150, I think. I read it as 90 to 150 somewhere. Just look it up, please.
90 to 150.
I think so. Just look it up. I'm not sure.
Okay, madam.
So look it up. Yeah. Okay.
Question complete.
Yeah, I think you mentioned most of the thing about starting with TEG and then Rotem and all that. And then you spoke about the platelet function, and then coagulation platelet function analyzer. Then you spoke about the clotting factor test, and then you spoke about the heparin test. And then these are all the point of care coagulation disorders. And what is most important is for you to understand that this TEG and Rotem are the most common ones which we use nowadays in obstetric, whether it's lost obstetric hemorrhage, or and of course ACT when it comes to cardiothoracic, cardiac surgery and all that patient, because nowadays every other patient is on ECMO and all that. So we need to know something about the ACT. So these are the two important things. And when they ask you a question on TEG or on this point of care coagulation, you are expected to draw that diagram of that like a fish, no? It'll be like a fish having the R and then the alpha angle, the all those what is it? And the slope, the attitude, the slope, the maximum altitude. Those things that you have to know. And what you specifically mentioned about the changes that happens in every system is something very nicely which you mentioned. And what you have to give. And as anesthetist, what we have to give when you see a particular problem with the coagulation. So that is what you need to mention when you talk about this. It is enough. It is not enough if you say this. And of course, you can also make a mention in the beginning before you talk about this, if you have the time. Because this is not a very big question. Of course, it's a difficult question, though it is not a big question. If you know about it, you can write everything. If you don't know about it, you don't have much to write, isn't it? If you don't know how to draw the diagram, but without drawing the diagram, it is quite incomplete. If you don't draw the diagram, it is quite incomplete, so it is not sufficient. So you must draw the diagram. And if you don't know much about it, what you can do is you can write a short thing about the coagulation, not all the factors. You can just write the cascade. You can say the extrinsic factor, intrinsic factor, and then the common factor and what happens with coagulation. And there you can mention at every, if you write that down, and then you can put arrows and say what test, point of test thing is valuable for, at that stage. If you write that, it will make more sense. Okay.
Okay.
So that's all about this. If you write that, it'll make a big difference, actually. Write that. And then you say about the drugs, about the use of aspirin, clopidogrel, this G2A and 3A and all that. So you write about those, and then you say how it can be interpreted, how the point of care coagulation test can be interpreted and treated according to that. So if you do that, then the whole thing is kind of complete. Good job. Because it is a difficult question, not everybody knows about it, but invariably they keep asking you in the exam about this point of care coagulation. In fact, lot of things are there for point of care itself, not only coagulation. We talk about coagulation because it's important to us, but several other tests are also being done, isn't it? Point of care tests, several other tests are also being done. You don't have to mention all that because there's no time. You write it like this. You write the coagulation and then you put the points. You say the drugs, then you draw the diagram and then mention it. All this is done. Okay. Yeah. All this is good. This is good. That's all you can do about this question. All right.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Let's write about the coagulation and introduce it. That's it.
Next question. Okay. Good job.
We can go to the next topic. Low flow. Low flow.
Low anesthesia. Hello, madam.
Yeah, you can start. I'm purposely muted so that you can clear, you can talk clearly.
Fine. Low flow anesthesia has various definitions. Basically, it's a technique that utilizes a fresh glass flow that is less than the alveolar ventilation, which can be classified as low flow anesthesia, or could be, less than 50% of the expired gas that has been returned to the lungs after the carbon dioxide absorption being done. So basically, a fresh glass flow less than 2 liters per minute would be termed as a low flow anesthesia technique. The main advantages of this technique is that the dangers of theater pollution associated with the trace amounts of anesthetic agents, and also considering the cost of these inhalation agents, would have helped the rediscovery of this technique. There is a basic classification of fresh glass flow given by Baker, where they term the metabolic flow as about 250 ml per minute. Minimal flow, they term it as 250 to 500 ml per minute. Low flow as 500 to 1000 ml per minute, and a medium flow of 1 to 2 liters per minute. So for most practical consideration, it is generally considered as less than 2 liters per minute as low flow anesthesia. The need for low flow anesthesia involves utilizing a fresh glass flow which is higher than the metabolic flows, by which is considerably less than the conventional flow. So being larger than the metabolic flow, it provides a greater margin of safety and allows variation in the fresh glass composition, and there will be a strict compliance to the uptake, which is not necessary, and which provides you a great simplified way, and also at the same time provides an economy of the fresh glass flow. So the concepts of low flow anesthesia involves the administration of the fresh glass mixture with a given composition of anesthetic gases. So the uptake depends primarily on the physical characteristics of each agent that is being included in the circuit. Exhale gas mixture mixes with a fresh glass flow, which will have a different composition due to the uptake of agent and addition of carbon dioxide that is being exhaled. So idea is to replenish the consumed gases with as minimal as fresh glass possible by eliminating the carbon dioxide that is being produced. So challenge is to control the dynamic equilibrium status of the fresh glass flow composition, as the uptake and metabolisms are time sensitive, and many factors interfere with the consumption and the products of various gases that is being included. So this is mainly this can be achieved by frequently adjusting the fresh gas flow at various levels. So for this, you have to have a proper monitoring of the inspired concentration of FiO2, that is a concentration of oxygen that is being inspired, as well as the end-tidal concentration of various gases, especially the inhalation agents, which will make us more accurate, and it will be very convenient for us to give a safe conduct of low flow anesthesia. So equipments that are required is for this low flow anesthesia include the minimal requirement for conduct of low flow anesthesia is absorption of CO2 from the expired gas, so that it can be reutilized for alveolar ventilation. The two systems were primarily used, 2-1-PRO system, which is an old one, which was introduced by Waters, and the circle system, which was introduced by Brian Swart. As 2-1-PRO is an old one, and it's more bulkier near the patient end, not used right now. Circle system using the large soda lime canister is very commonly used. The circle system configuration includes two unidirectional valves on the either side of the soda lime canister, fresh glass entry, reservoir bag, pop-off valve, and corrugated tubes, and a Y piece that is being connected to the patient end. So the relative position of the fresh gas entry, pop-off valve, and reservoir valve are immaterial as long as they are positioned between the expiratory and the inspiratory unidirectional valve, so that the proper absorption of CO2 occurs at all times in an efficient manner. So monitoring devices, as I said previously, we require an FiO2 monitoring. The inspired oxygen concentration should be monitored at all times, especially if nitrous oxide is used as one of the adjuvant gas. And the monitoring of end-tidal anesthetic concentration is also available. So the administration of low flow anesthesia becomes much more easier. So the practice of low flow anesthesia basically involves three parts or three categories, where the first one is the initiation of the low flow anesthesia, second is the maintenance, third one is the termination of the low flow anesthesia. So starting off with the initiation of the low flow anesthesia, the primary aim at the start of low flow anesthesia is to achieve a alveolar concentration of anesthetic agent that is adequate to produce surgical anesthesia, that is approximately 1.3 mAq. So the main factors that is being broadly classified in this group that allows us to give proper delivery of anesthetic agent in a low flow anesthesia are factors governing the inhaled tension of the anesthetic, factors responsible for the maintenance of this alveolar tension, and factors responsible for the uptake from the lungs that reduce the alveolar tension. So first is the factors governing the inhaled tension of the anesthetic. So basically the circle system, which is being quite commonly used, is bulkier and approximately it consumes about 6 to 7 liters. Apart from that, the FRC of the patient has to be taken into account, which will be roughly 3 liters. So together it is going to be 10 liters of anesthetic gases and vapors has to be added. So basically it requires 3 constant times for 95% change in the, that is 3 T halves approximately for 95% change in the gas concentration to occur. Next is the functional residual capacity of the lung, which has to be taken into account, which might contain whole of nitrogen, which will try to equilibrate the circuit volume and alter the concentration of the anesthetic gases. So proper denitrogenation has to be achieved at the start of the anesthesia, which can be either through a non-rebreathing mask or through a closed circuit with a large flow of oxygen through a tight sealed mask. The anesthetic agent could be also be lost in the breathing system due to the solubility of the agent in the rubber or permeability to the corrugated tube. So the amount of loss is quite minimal in these cases, but it has to be still considered quite significant if it's going to be a low flow anesthesia. The next factor is to responsible for the rise in the alveolar tension of the anesthetic gas, anesthetic agent. For this, they term the effect called as concentration effect. The concentration effect helps in raising the alveolar tension towards the inspiratory tension, but hinders it if there is an insoluble gas present in the mixture, which is commonly a nitrous oxide. So higher the inspired concentration, more rapid is the rise in the alveolar concentration. At low inspired concentration, the alveolar concentration results from the balance between the input as well as from the circulatory uptake. Similarly, if an insoluble gas like nitrogen is being present in the inspired mixture, the blood takes up the anesthetic gas and the concentration of the insoluble gas will further dilute the concentration of the anesthetic agent. Next is the alveolar ventilation. So greater the alveolar ventilation, more rapid is the rise of the alveolar concentration towards the inspired concentration. So this effect is being limited only by the lung volume, larger the functional residual capacity, so that there will be a slower wash in the anesthetic gas. Next factor is the factor that is responsible for the uptake from the lungs by reducing the alveolar tension. Uptake from the lung is determined by 3 factors: solubility of the agent in the blood, cardiac output, as well as the alveolar to venous partial pressure gradient. So blood gas solubility, the common term that is being used in the volatile agents is the blood gas solubility coefficient. Larger the blood gas solubility coefficient, the greater the uptake of anesthetic, slower the rate of rise of alveolar concentration. Next is the cardiac output. The blood carries the anesthetic away from the lungs. So the greater the cardiac output, greater the uptake, consequently the slower the rise of alveolar tension. So this is more applicable for the more soluble agents, anesthetic agents, which are more affected than the least soluble anesthetic agents in case of the factor called cardiac output. Next is alveolar to the venous partial pressure gradient. During the induction, the tissues removes all the anesthetic brought to them by the blood. This lowers the venous partial pressure much below the arterial blood partial pressure. So this results in a large alveolar to the venous anesthetic partial pressure difference, which causes maximum anesthetic uptake and hence lowers the alveolar partial pressure. So the basic points that has to be taken into account from this discussion is the induction, if performed using a low flows, would take unacceptably a long time. It won't be immediate. In low flows, it takes a long time. And if induction is done with an intravenous agent, unless specific precautions are taken, it will take a very long time to achieve the desired alveolar concentration. Once the desired concentration is achieved, it will be very difficult to change it, or the termination of action would take a longer period of time to occur.
Okay.
Is that okay, Manav? I'll proceed.
Yeah, fine. You're fine. I think you got all the points right. Yeah.
Next, during the low flow anesthesia, there are various methods to achieve desired gas and agent concentration. There are various methods. One is use of a high flows for a short period of time. That is, if a fresh glass flow of 10 liters, this is most commonly and the most effective technique of initiating a low flow anesthesia. By using high flows for a short period of time, the time constant is reduced. So for example, you have a 10 liters of desired concentration where a mixture of oxygen and nitrous with a 2 MAC inhalation agent for 3 minutes. That might be approximately value around the 3 time constants, which would give you an enough desired concentration. This is more commonly used technique. The other technique is pre-fill circuit, where you use a Megill circuit for a pre-oxygenation. So simultaneously, at a test lung bag is connected and the entire circuit is being filled with the mixture of desired concentration of gas. So this is another method of achieving a desired gas and agent concentration. And third method is use of large dose of anesthetic agents to achieve desired concentration, as well as it also compensates for the initial large anesthetic gas take up. Another technique is an injection technique, where you administer large volumes of agents by directly injecting the agent into the circuit in the form of vaporizer in circuit. That is commonly used. There is various calculations for this. The exact dose required for this can be calculated by a formula called priming dose, which is equal to desired concentration into functional residual capacity plus circuit volume, and also taking into the cardiac output and blood gas soluble coefficient. Next, the most important thing is,
you know, what is that called? What is that called? CLADS. You know that? That circuit?
What circuit, madam?
The CLADS circuit. The circuit.
Closed loop anesthesia delivery system.
Yes, yes, that is what you have to mention that now. Because you're mentioning about, because if you're mentioning about the recent one where you're injecting the volatile agent in the circuit, inside the circuit, it is it's a specialized method of injecting the inhalation agent in the circuit, isn't it? There we use a specific amount of the solution of the inhalation agent, and that gets vaporized. It's injectable, right? It's called the closed loop anesthesia delivery system. And that is the most recent one among the techniques that we're using nowadays. Okay, so there you can mention the CLADS. In fact, I think Ludhiana, somewhere where Ludhiana, it's done in our country somewhere. Ludhiana, I think somebody very, very famous will keep doing it all the time. I think it's Ludhiana. Yeah, anyway, look it up. The CLADS. That can be a short notes for you. The closed loop anesthesia delivery system is the most recent one, and that is the thing which is mentioned for the green OT and all that. They can ask you questions based on this. Low flow anesthesia basically is because you want to prevent contamination and things like that. So for green OT, you know, that is the concept of a green OT. So the CLADS came, and TIVA, CLADS, all this is for green OT concept.
Next is the maintenance of a low flow anesthesia. This is the most important phase, as this is stretched over a period of time, and most financial saving procedures occur in this period of maintenance. This phase is characterized by there is a need for a steady state of anesthesia, often meaning maintaining a steady alveolar concentration of the respiratory gases, oxygen, nitrous, as well as the volatile agent. Minimal uptake of anesthetic agents by the body, and also there will be a need for prevention of hypoxic gas mixture being delivered during the low flow anesthesia to the patient. So the management of the oxygen and nitrous oxide flow during the maintenance phase is more important, and there are various techniques that has been commonly used to management of the oxygen and nitrous flow during the maintenance period. Common technique is Gothenburg technique, where during the induction for the first 6 minutes, they give oxygen at 1.5 liters per minute, nitrous at 3.5 liters per minute. During the maintenance phase, the oxygen will be calibrated around 4 ml per kg per minute, and nitrous is adjusted to maintain constant oxygen concentration using an analyzer to maintain to prevent the delivery of hypoxic mixture. So this is the most commonly used technique, which is called as Gothenburg technique. And other salient points that has to be considered during the maintenance phase are the leaks. There will be some leaks that has to be meticulously sought out for and prevented, since this would decrease the efficacy of the system. And accordingly, you have to adjust the flows to compensate for the leaks that is being happening. And the most of the gas monitors have a sample gases which sample at a rate of 200 ml per minute, which might be quite significant in case of a low flow anesthesia, has to be returned back to the circuit to maximize the economy of the fresh glass flow. And the next thing would be finally the termination of the low flow anesthesia. Unlike the initiation, the termination is much more simple and it's less controversial. There are two recognized methods for the termination of the low flow anesthesia. One is the flushing out technique. Another is using by the use of charcoal containing canister. Flushing out technique: towards the end of the anesthesia, the circuit is opened and high flow of gas is used to flush out the anesthetic agents, which accelerates the washout of the anesthetic agents. This is quite simple, but there will be a lot of wastage, results in the wastage of gases. Second method is the use of activated charcoal.
All the saving that you have done for all the 4 hours will be gone when you do the flushing at the end of this, isn't it? It's quite a silly
thing. It was commonly used previously, I think, madam, but...
Not used nowadays. That's right. Exactly. Yeah.
Second method is the activated charcoal, where an activated charcoal is heated to 220 degrees Celsius, which absorbs the potent vapors almost completely. And it is usually contained in the canister, which will be used with a bypass placed in the circuit. It results in a rapid recovery as well as reducing the theater pollution. Nitrous oxide, due to its low solubility, usually washed off at the end by using 100% oxygen. To conclude, the advantages of low flow anesthesia: its enormous financial savings will be there by the use of low flow techniques. High humidity in the system which is being maintained, leads to fewer post anesthetic complications. The maintenance of body temperature during prolonged procedures will be there due to the conservation of the heat. Another important thing is the reduction in the theater pollution. Disadvantages are very few, but they are not very real. But it requires a more accurate adjustment of the flow of gases. So they require oxygen monitors like analyzers for monitoring the to prevent the delivery of hypoxic mixture. And accumulation of trace gases might be there, which might be overestimated. The proper understanding of this practice, the low flow can be safely used in all surgical procedures lasting for more than an hour. Can be used, this technique can be used. That ends my presentation.
All right, okay, yeah, that's a very good presentation. You mentioned everything, and you were talking about the delay, the recovery phase. And what are all the causes of delay in recovery? Suppose you're using a low flow technique. And you understood the concept quite well. You understood about how it goes from the system to the alveolus, from the alveolus to the gut, and then to the brain, and then how all that uptake distribution is basically uptake distribution of the volatile anesthetic agents, isn't it? So that aspect of it was very good. But what happens if you're using a low flow technique for a surgery which lasts for 4 to 5 hours and the patient does not recover very well? What is the problem?
Probably the delivery of the volatile might be much more.
For it to come out, same thing, same problem. For it to come out of the circulation and come onto the lung and come out itself will take a long time. Okay, so what you're supposed to do is to prevent this delay in the recovery, you can assess the timing of the surgery and switch off the vaporizer quite early, about 15 minutes early. Okay. Rather than keeping on for a longer time. Yeah, and then if you need to think, you can supplement with a small intravenous intravenous agent just to keep the patient so that that does not become very deep. At the same time, patient does not wake up. You must also be sure that the patient doesn't wake up at the end of it. No? After a long procedure, they suddenly start waking up again, it's going to be a problem. So that is something we have to just keep in mind. You can just add on. That is a question which can add on, where we can switch off and start off to IV. And then, of course, sometimes they say you have to give SAME move. When you put the patient on ventilator and then you want to switch over, you can switch over to SAME mode so that it will be better to use it. And another thing is, another important thing which I want to say was, of course, at the beginning you said how to start off with the low flow technique, and I mean start off with the high flow and then switch on. So this is when you have those points coming into view about the reserve volume, isn't it? The main thing is the reserve volume, which is in the apparatus, which you said already, and the dead space and other things of the patient. So these both of them you mentioned that, but it was not so clear. What you mentioned there in the beginning was not so clear. So that aspect you write better, okay? And then of course you spoke about the residual volume, fresh gas flow, all that was correct, all that was fine. And then you said, did you say about the dilution of the inhalation agent, of the volatile agent, dilution of oxygen and dilution of inhalation agent, which is a problem, and that's why you said, I think you mentioned, about the use of analyzer, about the use of analyzer, oxygen analyzer, not to prevent giving hypoxic mixtures. Very, very important. So if you want to have low flow anesthesia in your machines, you must make sure that you have all these monitors. You can't give low flow anesthesia to a patient with metabolic flow or whatever flow you want to give with the normal machine that you have. You can't say, I will give minimal flow, I'll give metabolic flow, I will give low flow or that with a normal anesthesia machine. You can't do that. You must have the monitors. You must have oxygen analyzer. You must have end tidal values. You must have the MAC value. With that only, you can give low flow anesthesia. Otherwise, it is absolutely unsafe to use low flow if you don't have these monitors. So just because you're listening to a lecture somewhere where they're talking all about the merits of low flow anesthesia, and you don't have those monitors in the hospital that you're practicing, don't practice it. So you must know to how to handle these patients. So that is something which you have to keep in mind. Just a practical thing. As a theory thing, it's fine. Whatever you said as a theory, it's quite fine. And then you said about, did you say about how it improves the pulmonary? You didn't say. You did not say how it improves actually the pulmonary function itself. When you use a low flow versus high flow, they've done a lot of studies and they ventilated the patient. When they found that you have a low fresh gas flow, it improves the dynamics of the inhaled anesthetic gases. And only because of that, they actually get under quite well. And that is why the recovery is also delayed. It also, of course, you said about maintenance of the body temperature and humidification. It's a big advantage. Maintenance of the body temperature and humidification is a big advantage, which we do not have when you use just the circle absorber. So what you can write is minimal requirement for a patient who needs to go on low flow. Okay, so then you say about the merits, then you say about the demerits, then you say about, because you said the demerits are quite a few, because the unpredictable uptake of nitrous oxide. Main thing is nitrous oxide. Main culprit in this low flow technique will be nitrous oxide, because the uptake of nitrous oxide is unpredictable. You really can't say how much of nitrous oxide is going in. So that is why we need to have a proper monitor. So if I look through your presentation of whatever you have done, starting from the beginning to the thing, you have covered all the topics, no problem at all. So otherwise it was quite good. Everything was good. Then did you say about carbon monoxide? I think you did not say about carbon monoxide.
No.
So that I think you have to mention, isn't it? From the desiccated absorbent, the absorbent that you're using, the desiccated absorbent carbon monoxide. This is something which you need to keep in mind. Though we know that it's not there, you have to mention that.
Okay.
So you have to use a fresh soda lime all the time. Okay. You cannot use something which is already there. So if it's a desiccated soda lime, then if there is a low flow and you're using a low flow, so definitely carbon monoxide will increase in the system. And the patient can inhale carbon monoxide and end poisoning because of that. And again, another important thing, I think among this carbon monoxide, what is mentioned is desflurane more than isoflurane will react with this carbon dioxide absorbent. So you need to be careful when you're using low flow anesthesia and desflurane. So this is just a practical aspect of the thing which I'm trying to tell you all.
Okay.
So just keep that in mind. Yeah. And of course, you have to mention. It's not incomplete. It's quite incomplete if we do not mention substance A with the SEO student. Though we know it doesn't happen in clinical practice and all that, you have to mention it. That's all. Okay. Otherwise, your presentation was very good. I'll mark you at least 70% of the marks. Excellent. Very good. I think today all three of you did well. Only thing is, this is easy to write. The point of care coagulation is quite difficult because you don't do it all the time. Low flow is something which we do all the time. And liver transport is a very practical clinical thing, which definitely you'll be able to write very well. But it's a very long question. So what you need to understand is, when you're writing a theory paper, you must, just because the liver transplant is so big, you take all the time in the world to write that, and then you don't take enough time to write the low flow or the TEG or other things, then you will lose your marks. So make sure that you divide the timing in such a way that you get out the salient feature of every question. Okay? So write points. Try to write points. Very good. All three of you did well today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam.
If you want any help, please call.
Thank you. A very useful session today. And once again, I thank Dr. Vasili, Professor Vasili madam, for highlighting the importance of BMJ students' free access to knowledge. Madam, can you share the link for us?
I'll look it up because I some time since I did it. I'll look it up and I'll tell you.
Okay, madam. That will be very useful, and we can advise our students to present some important review articles from such journals. So we'll cover up journal activities also, madam. Journal club activities.
Yes,
also.
Yes, yeah. BJ is one of the best. BJ education. There's something called BJ education. So okay. That is what is so important. That is important. I'll look it up because it's a long time since I looked it up myself. So I'll look it up.
Okay, madam. Thank you, madam. Thank you. Thank you all the participants. Thank you. We'll meet again on Friday with Professor Nagasamy sir for a set up another 5 questions. Thank you, madam. I'll sign off this meeting, madam. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.